Hi, everyone. I am not surprised to see a very packed room here. There's so much interest in and curiosity around and confusion over WeWork, a 7-year-old company that's now among the most highly valued privately held companies in the world. Is it a co-working space? Is it a real estate company? Is it a technology company? We're going to try to get to some of those answers today with your help. Adam, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
There's so much to cover and we don't have a whole lot of time. So I thought maybe if you'll indulge me, we could just go through some sort of cold hard stats and then get into your different business lines.
Our pleasure.
So you have 2,000 employees.
2,200 as of today.
Okay, 800 of them in New York.
About 800 of them in New York.
Okay. 130 customers who you refer to as members. So is that correct?
Over 130,000.
Okay. And are they, I know that we would talked and I think, did you say 60% are in the U.S. or 60% are outside of the U.S.?
So the U.S. is approximately 60%, between 55 to 60%.
Okay, great. And then you've got two businesses primarily. You've got WeWork, which was established 7 years ago, and then you've got a much newer business, WeLive. So of those 130,000 members, you're counting both businesses?
So the main business today is WeWork, and that's the leading business. So WeWork has 180 buildings around the world. WeLive is only 2 buildings, so it's a smaller piece.
Oh,
and then
okay.
Our digital services represents approximately 8% of the total businesses, which is the service store and the We membership.
Right, which we'll get to, which I find very interesting. So also very interesting to me, I don't know if you guys realize this, but I think this is fascinating. The average person in the United States lives in 450 square feet. At a WeLive, people are living in 180 square feet. Similarly, at WeWork, people are operating in about 50 square feet, and the average space in which people operate is typically around 250 square feet. So it's fascinating to me that you're sort of, in a way, turning a lack of privacy into a competitive advantage. How do you do that?
So also, when we say for WeLive, we said 180 square foot per person. In our first WeLive in New York City, you actually have 27 floors with 27 common spaces. So there's a lot more access to kitchens, and if it's a bar or a restaurant downstairs or just a library or a quiet room that you can sit and read in, there's a lot more of that than just in your apartment. Same thing with WeWork. Even though WeWork is 50 square foot per person, a third of all WeWork spaces are actually open in open common spaces that give access to everybody that we don't measure as seats. So there's a lot more room there.
Right.
So the way we do it is people think that WeWork is all open. It's not true. 90% of WeWork space is actually office. 10% is only open space. But we create a lot of common space for everybody. It's not that the lack of privacy is more important. It's that community, being surrounded by a group of like-minded individuals, being part of something bigger than yourself, inspires people to work harder, spend more time at work, and just have fun doing it.
I think it's really interesting and an overlooked fact that only 10% of your office space is open space. Because there's so many companies that are trying to replicate what you're doing. I had just read about Deloitte in Toronto merging a number of offices and to create a beautiful open space. I think there's a big misimpression about that ratio.
I think the open space, as we can tell here, we're having an awesome conversation. I can hear a lot of noise outside
right. And
hardly hear myself. Open spaces are overrated. It has to be structured in the right way. When you design a space, salespeople might need open. Someone might need an enclosed space. Mm-hmm. Engineers actually sometimes need a more quiet and peaceful environment. So it depends on the use case. And what we really pride ourselves is using data and a lot of systems to understand what is the best space for people and then actually deliver the product that's going to make them most successful.
And you even use sensors toward that end, which I'm hoping we can get to. But you also have a very high-paying membership and high margins. Members pay you on average $8,000 a year, and your margins are about 40%.
So those numbers are pretty accurate for the U.S. As
okay.
you start going bigger to China, to India, to Latin America, those numbers change. But
okay.
for the United States, that's a good, and we think of it more as $650 a month, as a month-to-month opportunity, but if you want to think of it yearly, that's correct also.
Okay. And now, I'm a horrible mathematician, I'm an English major, but I sort of, with my crummy math, had figured you were sort of on an 800 million-ish annual run rate, which would put you at about $1 billion run rate sometime in 2017, which I think is something that you had sort of predicted last year would be the case.
So last year when we spoke, I said $1 billion run rate in the following year, and I'm happy to let everyone know that we're on track for that $1 billion run rate for this year.
That's a lot of revenue. Are you profitable?
So we are on, as per choice, because when you have a 40% business, when you have a margin, you can actually choose when to be profitable.
Right.
We like to hover around the EBITDA break even, and then we can choose when we want to move, where we want to move. Right now, we're in a very high growth stage of our business, and we don't see that stopping anytime soon.
Okay. Now, so WeWork is pretty complicated and fascinating. There's obviously a big physical component here, and so people understand. So basically, somebody bids on a property to develop, you partner with the, I know it's hard to hear, you partner with a management company, and then you sort of work with them and you divide up your revenue. I think that was a sort of a smaller percentage of revenue at some point. Now maybe it's up to 50%. That's accurate?
So in the past, WeWork would take leases. As the business grew and as we proved to landlords that by creating WeWork spaces, we're actually attracting more tenants, we're making the members or the tenants that are inside the building actually happier, and more people wanted to share the spaces, landlords started approaching us and said, what if we did a management deal, actually split the profits 50-50, we will pay for the build out and make us a completely asset light business. Right now in India, we are growing into India 100% asset light. So we have a partner in India that's paying for everything and we split the profits, same thing in Israel. And we now have buildings all over the world where we're entering these management agreements.
And this is, you're just now entering India. So this is sort of...
So India, I'm happy to announce that July 1st, we're gonna open our first location in India. And by the end of this year, we're gonna have Mumbai, New Delhi, and Bangalore.
Okay.
But we've been working on this for over a year and management agreements started about 3 years ago, but now we're doing more and more of them.
Okay, wonderful. This is a sort of old, but reports have said that it takes 9 months from the time you sign a lease until you get the tenants in. Is that still the case?
So we actually have the ability, that's a lever that we can pull. We can move very fast from when we sign to when we open. We could do it as quickly as 4 months if we need to. We've even broken that record in the past. Actually, our head of product is sitting in front of me, and if I say anything else, he might get a heart attack. 9 months is a comfortable amount of time to do things.
Okay.
We can do it faster if we need to.
You also have a growing enterprise business. If you could tell us a little bit about that.
So from the beginning, we always knew that we didn't want to just take care of the smaller member and the startup. It was always about an ecosystem and a community. And a good community needs large companies, small companies, and everything in between. Over the past 2 years, more and more enterprise customers have come to us and asked, can you give the WeWork energy? Can you bring the WeWork culture to us? And we said, no, we're not ready. Now that WeOS, our operating system for commercial space, is starting to ramp up and we're starting to be ready to deploy it, we're starting to take more and more enterprise customers. And 2 years ago, that business was 0% of our total sales. Today, that represents 30% of our new business. So last month, 30% of the new business was enterprise. Some enterprises choose to come and be inside WeWork, and some are actually asking us to put WeOS, our operating system, and our community managers inside their spaces.
So for people who aren't familiar with WeOS, and I certainly was not, explain a little bit about what this is. It's sort of like a social network for everyone who is a WeWork customer. Is that
so? There's two different parts. There's the We membership and WeOS. If you have We membership, you have access to all of our physical spaces, and the platform behind We membership is WeOS. But also, just as something to everybody here, we'll talk afterwards about the service store. But anybody here who checks out and signs up for the service store, we're gonna give the crowd today 3 months of We membership on WeWork to experience what a We membership is. And all you have to do to get that is go to store.wework.com, sign up, and you'll immediately get 3 months. You need to put the code of TC Disrupt, and you will be in. We're gonna keep that open till the end of the day, and everyone can experience for themselves what a We membership is. But a We membership gives you access to all the physical space and then gives you access to all of the services, all of our members and everything in between. WeOS is the operating system of the physical space. So start with simple things like how you enter a building and then how you book a conference room and how you register a guest. But from that point on, you can start layering more and more things onto the physical graph that can control the interactions between an individual, a place, and a time that they want to do it. And the more we can track those different things, the more that we can give better services to the individuals that are interested in it. So with enterprise, for example, you could have a great company with an awesome common space, but no one uses it. We'd be able to see through sensors and through different aspects of WeOS that space is not being used and reallocate it to something more meaningful. Because at the end of the day, we're trying to help our members create their life's work and not just a living. And for that, we want them to have an amazing experience. And these are all things that help us create a better experience.
And these members who are in the service store, this is pretty nascent, the service store.
Service store is brand new. Okay. I could say two words about that.
Sure.
So Service Store is, and everyone can check it out, is a curation of services that we've done for our members, especially the smaller members, so the ones with companies with less than 100 employees. And when you're a small business today or a startup, you could easily find yourself using 50 to 70 different services just to run your business month to month. We went and explored all the services that are being offered, or a lot of the services in the US. We curated the top 200, we streamlined through there and our API, a connection to those services. And if today you're in the service store, you could buy Slack, Salesforce, and Microsoft for small business just at the press of a button. And once you're a member, you get a 30 to 50% discount on all of these things. You also get us representing you. A lot of services that you buy today, you got to commit for a year. So we negotiated with the service providers to give it a month to month, so the member can just check it out, or the person using the service store can just experience it. And we launched it 2 weeks ago. A third of the entire member base in the US has entered. An average of 2 employees per company have checked it out, and 10% of all of our members have purchased something on the service store, which for us is a lot. We're very excited about that response. I can also tell you that our members right now, their favorite 3 services are Slack, Salesforce, and a cool integration that we did with Lyft.
Okay, great. Oh, so I was gonna ask, what about partners? I mean, it seems like, you know, companies live and die by partnerships. One could sort of see WeWork partnering with many sort of big on-demand providers like a Lyft, like an Uber, maybe even like with an Airbnb. Are you talking about those types of things?
So yes, we are talking about those type of partnerships. And as you start controlling the physical graph, and as WE membership becomes your personal ID, your physical passport, you can then use that to basically book an Uber, connect to an Airbnb, or do anything in between. But also we're partnering with larger service providers like Salesforce, for example, which has a lot of products for small businesses and medium-sized businesses. And a company like that that gets us and we get them, and we know that they're very committed to their customer, is a great partnership for us. So today we can tell Salesforce, hey, our members are looking for these things, and we have someone listening, ready to build product that really is ready to serve the small business and the startup world.
And so there's also room, presumably, for like financial services and insurance.
So it's divided to productivity and financial services and things that you need for the office and anything in between. And yes, in each one of the categories, we've curated what we found to be the best services. As now we get more and more information, we're going to see what small businesses really need to do to succeed. We're going to give feedback to those service providers, build better products with them, or just find other service providers if we feel that the ones we have are not meeting the demands of our members and the needs.
Let's go back to the enterprise piece. So this is fairly new. You said it now accounts for 30% of your revenue in the US, I think you said. Do you plan to cap at some point what percentage of enterprise companies you're going to come? Because it seems like you're so focused on culture, and I don't know if you can maintain that sort of the feel of the WeWork with.
So I think that's an excellent question. Our focus is culture, and we can talk about that more afterwards. But you're right. When you bring in enterprise, you have to ask yourself, am I changing the environment that we've created and worked so hard to create? But here's the thing that we're learning about enterprise. The kind of departments in enterprise that choose to be in WeWork are very similar to our members. Average age is about 30 to 35, and everyone wants to create their life's work, and everyone wants to do what they love. And the fact that they chose to work for a larger organization doesn't mean they're not as passionate and as excited about life and about the world. So we're finding a lot of correlation. Saying that, we're keeping a very close eye on it, and there's definitely a cap. We're trying to establish it right now, but no question that there's a cap.
But they obviously do sign longer leases, which is good for business.
So we don't do leases, we do membership agreements, but yes, they do sign longer membership agreements, substantially longer, especially when we need to build a space that fits them. So from month to month, we're offering our small members also year-to-year agreements that some members really prefer. And for those larger enterprises, we can do anything as short as month to month, but our deals now are 3 to 5 years, and we have an enterprise that tells us that if we don't give them a 10-year commitment, they're not willing to do it, so we're exploring those deals also.
How much square footage are you managing altogether at this point?
It changes a lot. You're opening between 500,000 to 1 million square feet a month, so it grows very quickly, but you're managing approximately, depending if you're doing New York loss factor or no New York loss factor, about 20 million square feet.
Okay. So I know this is your least favorite topic, but let's talk a little bit about your funding and your valuation. That's okay.
I love the topic. There's not a lot we can say about it, but I'm excited to hear.
So how much have you raised so far, officially?
We have raised officially 1.8 billion, I think is the numbers that are communicated publicly.
Okay, and that is at a $17 billion valuation?
The last raise was a 600 million at around the $17 billion valuation.
Okay, so, you know, people always say, well, there's tons of competitors, co-working spaces have taken off, you've got Industrious here, you have a traditional broker, Regus, which is decades old, and I think manages twice the square footage that you do roughly right now. So they try to understand how to put your valuation into context. I mean, should you be valued as a real estate company or as a technology company?
So we actually don't view ourselves as a real estate company or as a technology company. We used to say that we're a community company, but we're starting to figure out now that we ourselves are still discovering what is that best type of company that we want to be. And the most important thing for us is, just like we like to learn from other people, we want to set an example for other companies. So today when I think of the world and I think of non-for-profit and I think of that word, why is a group of people dedicating their lives to make other people's lives better called non-for-profit? I could argue that they're making the most profit in the world. And then we have for-profit companies that are making things, if it's, let's say, things that are made of wood and they're cutting a lot of trees to get there, and why is the fact that you can make money from cutting trees making you for profit? So what we're really doing is we're taking best practices out of the for-profit world, best practices out of the non-for-profit world, bringing those two things together. That's the type of company that we're going to be. We really want to be a company that sets an example but also lives by their own words. And that's the kind of company we are. And I actually believe in the future that you're going to see a very exciting multiple for companies that really treat other people the way they want to be treated and really feel like they're part of something greater than themselves. When our company makes a decision of a new category that we go into, the question we have to answer is, can we make a meaningful difference in our members' life? Will this move make a difference in the world? And if the answer is yes, then of course we want to do it. And if it's no, then that's not for us to do.
Well, it would be nice if shareholders recognize that as a new category. I guess we'll see.
We love that new category. We're thinking about it a lot.
So I know you can't comment on this, but there have been reports that you're raising, I think, around $3 billion from SoftBank. Can you comment on that?
I really can't comment.
I think one thing that kind of concerned people in Silicon Valley, at least, was related reporting that $1 billion of that was going to come in the form of the secondary. One prominent VC, who I won't out right now, tweeted about those reports, "Kiss goodbye whatever discipline and grit was left in WeWork. A $1 billion secondary is corruption defined." I'm guessing you
are. Wow.
Yes.
Who wrote that?
I cannot say.
Okay, I think public information.
But I'm guessing you would disagree.
Well, here's the best answer. So, like I said, I can't comment about that, but I definitely can comment about secondary. And I do think that in a world that companies are staying private longer, we have employees that have been with us for, we're a 7-year-old company, we have a lot of employees that have been with us from day one. Actually, we pride ourselves with the fact that most of the employees choose to stay with us, even the ones who are fully vested. And it's a lot based on the culture. And when an employee in any company chooses to put their life towards a company, maybe takes a lower salary, gets equity promised to them, but then there's never an ability for them, or not never, but it gets really delayed because companies are able to stay private longer because of the environment that exists today, I think it's important to really think as a company, is there something we can do for the employees? And is there something we can do for the right employees? So I do think, I've seen companies do it. If you do it right for those companies, and if they really take culture in hand, I do think there's a way to do it that's correct. But that's as far as I can comment on the topic.
Right, right. Well, I think there's plenty of founders who would agree with you. Last question. We're in a very long boom period, which we've talked about on stage a little bit here today. There will be a recession at some point. People say of WeWork, how can they possibly survive a recession? You've said, in fact, it would be, you're not looking forward to a recession, but you think companies will downsize and work in WeWork. Other people say, those might be disposable employees, or the other sort of creatives that are working there are going to go work in their bedrooms and basements again. So how do you protect yourself in a downside scenario?
So I think thinking of a downside is something important for everybody that's here. I think different environments call for different moves. As your company gets bigger and your balance sheet is larger and you have commitments that are annual commitments and commitments that are 3 years and 5 years, it's easier to think through how you're going to work through it. But I think the most important thing to understand if there is actual intention behind what your business does and it's actually serving a real need, that need does not go away in a recession. Maybe things change, maybe things are not going to be exactly the same, but if you're serving a true need and if you have a loyal group of members or customers that are following you and are committed to you, be sure as a fact that as the world goes through a tough time, these customers, at least the ones who can, will stay with you. For us personally, as we move into enterprise and move into longer term relationships, that helps a lot of that. As our balance sheet grows, that's an easy thing. But the thing to think is business is a flexible thing. Space is fixed. Being able to give people that flexibility if that recession or when that recession comes is actually going to be a very needed product. An early version of WeWork called Green Desk was founded in May of 2008. We had no brand, no money, no 2,000 employees. We actually had one employee and we did amazing. And when this recession comes, and I agree, it's not an if but a when, we will go to our community and tell them, ask them, can you please first do business internally before you do externally? If they will need our help, we will extend as much help as they need it because we believe in them and we believe in this world in the long run. And the truth is, for a company like us on the space side, even it's becoming smaller and smaller, when that day comes, we will actually take a lot more space and grow a lot faster and use that as an opportunity so when our members are ready to grow again, we've been able to build a platform for them that they need. Same thing about technology. For WeOS, we expect to see us acquiring companies over the next 12 months, and some that we have, we just haven't published yet. Those opportunities are going to give us the opportunity to find some of the best partners in the world and partner with them, either through acquisition, through partnership, to be stronger together as a we, as opposed to a me. And really, what bothers me and worries me the most is culture. Can we maintain the culture, and how do we build a better culture? I'm really not worried about the recession.
Well, I find the company fascinating, and I'm looking forward to seeing where it goes.
Thank you.
Adam, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.